Okay, so we left the previous video with the code, and you'll see the code is the same. The result is still 14, it's 11 plus 3, and we have the span output here with a name called add, and that happens because on line 19, we start a current span and call it add. But there are various other fields that it's worth understanding in this span. So we have a trace ID and a span ID, and I'll go into those in more detail in a different video. We have a span kind. We have a parent ID, which is null, and that means that there is no parent span to this. This was the first span that was created. We have a start and an end time, which makes sense. That's the time this unit of work started and finished. So by subtracting those, we understand how long this unit of work took. We have a status, which at the moment is unset. We have attributes, events, links, and some resource sections. So how do we start building out this span to give us more information for day two operations? So when we've actually coded this and we're using this in production to, you know, figure out when something goes wrong, what went wrong, how do we enrich this span with the right data? Okay, first let's understand the span kind. So if we have a look at the OpenTelemetry website, we'll see the specification for a trace is shown there, and the possible span kinds are server, client, producer, consumer, or internal. Now, as you can see there, the default value is internal, and what that means is this unit of work happens only within the program. There are no outgoing or incoming calls to other services or pieces of code or services, microservices, that occur. So actually, in this case, internal is probably the correct span kind. Now, if we have a look at the span status and flick across again to the OpenTelemetry website, we'll see the possible values for the status of a span. A span has one of three statuses: unset, okay, or error. So this is really a way to denote what state your span is in. Is the thing that you were trying to do okay? Is the operation good? Do you not know? Is it unset, or are you in some sort of error state? So let's get to it. How do we actually set the status of this span? Firstly, we need to get a reference to the current span. So we do trace get current span, and we'll call it, if I can type, current span. Next, we can say current span dot set status. And we access the codes through the trace object. So trace.status code dot error, okay, or unset. I'm going to set it to okay, save and run the code. And you'll now see that the status has okay. What about the attributes? What are attributes? Well, attributes are just key value pairs. So bits of information that you want to attach to this span so that future you or the operations team know what was going on. So for example, if this method acted differently depending on the numbers that came in, you may get different response times. So let's add the values of first and second as attributes so that our operations team members know what was going on and can try and figure out how you wrote the code. So we can do that in a couple of different ways. We can individually call the set attribute, where the key is, let's say, first value, and the value is the actual numerical value of first, and we repeat that line to say second value. Run the code again, and now you'll see that in the attributes block we have the first value is 11 and the second value is 3. The alternative, rather than messing your code up like that, is to pass it in a single block. So it accepts a dictionary where first value is first, second value is second. They both achieve the same thing, so you pick which one you prefer. So moving down the trace, what are events? Well, events are a point in time on a timeline. They're not necessarily full spans. They are events that happen within a span. So of course, the design is really up to you whether you want a subspan or you just want to put a dot on the timeline, so to speak. So let's add an event here. Now to do that, I'm gonna have to, because this happens so quickly, I'm gonna artificially add some delay. So I'll just do time.sleep, sleep for a second. I'll do that twice. And in the middle of there, I will put our event code. And the event is called my event, and the event itself has attributes. Now you may choose to use those or not, it really, whether it makes sense or not. And then the event has a timestamp, and I'm just saying, you know, time.time in nanoseconds. So basically the time, the current time. So let's run that and see what we get. Okay, so our start time for the span is 08:51:58. Our end time for the span is 08:52:00. And at 08:51:59, so yes, within a second, after a second of the span starting, we have the event and the attributes for the event. The last block I want to cover in here is this resource block. Now, the resource block basically denotes the kind of physical entity or the thing from where this span originated. So in, you know, in a containerized world or Kubernetes world, it would, the resource might be a pod. So let's add some resource information to tell our observability systems that this span came from my MacBook Air. To do that, I need to import something new, which is opentelemetry.sdk.resources. I'll import the resource. And then I'll create a resource, and a resource has attributes. I have a certain OS version, and these, again, these attributes are key value pairs that you decide. So you build up, you decide what information is useful for you. In my case, I'm saying it's cluster A and the data center is in Brisbane. And the final piece is that when we create the provider, the tracer provider, we need to pass it the resource. So you'll notice the span is exactly the same, but in this time in the resource section, we have attributes. The service name is Adam's MacBook Air, the operating system version, the cluster, and the data center, and so on. Now, a final thought about all of these key value pairs and all of this metadata. It would be very tempting to add absolutely everything that you may want to add or that you could add. Think though, firstly about data privacy. The more you add, these spans are going to be stored somewhere, and if that ever leaked, you can't leak what you don't have. So don't add, you know, usernames, passwords, credit card numbers at all, and really think, do I actually need this? Can I obfuscate it? Can I do something else? Do I really need it? And the second point is storage costs, because wherever you store these, someone somewhere is going to be paying for that extra JSON storage. And remember, you won't just have one span here. You'll have millions and millions and millions of spans. So the price adds up. So I hope this was useful. In the next video, we'll actually take these spans and start passing them to an observability backend to start visualizing these in a little bit more friendly format than just looking at the console. And I'll also introduce the concept of semantic attributes. So join me again then. Thanks for watching.